A restless generation, we're turning over every stone, hoping to find salvation in a world that's left us cold. Can we get back to the altar, back to the arms of our first love? There's only one way to the Father, and He's calling out to us. To the captive, it looks like freedom. To the orphan, it feels like home. To the skeptic, it might sound crazy to believe in a God who loves. In a world where our hearts are breaking, and we're lost in the mess we've made, like a blinding light in the dead of night, it's the gospel. Our condition, it's the good news for us all. It's greater than religion, it's the power of the cross. So can we get back to the altar, back to the arms of our first love? There's only one way to the Father, and He's calling out to us. To the captive, it looks like freedom. To the orphan, it feels like home.
Received us into His.
In my own life, it means forgiveness when I know I deserve the fall. It called me out of my darkness and carried me to the cross. In a moment, my eyes were open. In that moment, my heart was changed, like a blinding light in the dead of night. It's the gospel. We're turning over every stone, hoping to find salvation in a world that's left us cold. Can we get back to the altar, back to the arms of our first love? There's only one way to the Father, and He's calling out to us. To the captive, it looks like freedom.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. It's such a blessing to come this today to magnify the Lord. The Bible says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me." He also says, "This is a day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it." It's a wonderful day to praise the Lord. I know sometimes we go through a lot, different circumstances, different situations in our lives, but I just want to pause and just magnify the Lord in spite of car issues, in spite of all the drama. I just want to magnify the Lord and say thank you, Jesus, for all you have done for me. And anyone today just want to say, you know what, in spite of all the difficulties I'm going through, I'm just going to pause and magnify the Lord and just give him the glory, give him the praise. And I just want to say thank you, Jesus, for all you have done for me. It's always a blessing to give God glory and to give him the praise, because he is worthy of all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. And so we're just going to do that. Thank you for tuning in today. Thank you. It's always a joy to see you on at Power Hour. It's Power Hour time, and it's time to pray. It's time to get in the Word. It's time to fellowship together. And I'm just glad to have this great privilege of magnifying the Lord today through the book of Acts chapter 5 and chapter 6. So with no further ado, you can type your prayer request in the chat, and we will do the regular custom, which is to pray for you. Yes, at Maranatha, we love to pray. We want to pray for you. And so I'm waiting on the chat. I see the chats coming in. Nice, nice, nice. And we're going to be praying together. We're going to be praying together. Those right now, they're in Power Hour and they are praying. They're lifting up prayers and raising holy hands and calling on Jesus on your behalf and all of our behalf. And so, at this moment, we are going to pray. Father, we ask you that your Holy Spirit will come by here. We ask you that on this virtual space that you'll take charge. I pray that Jesus alone will be seen. I pray that he will be exalted at the moment, because I know that the gospel still makes a way. And so Jesus, in spite of the challenges, in spite of the difficulties, Lord, we can pause and talk to you. We can pause and glorify your name. We can pause and say, thank you, Jesus, for coming through for me. And so this, at this moment, Lord, we call upon you for the sick. You know the hurt. You know the pain. You know the struggle. You know the situation. And now, God, we ask you that your Holy Spirit will just take charge and take control, oh God, to the point where we'll see sick being healed. The Lord God, we'll hear different reports. The doctors say, no more can I do, or I can't do anything else. But I know, Lord, when doctors fail, that you'll never fail. So if it's your will, God, we ask you to do mighty move in the lives of the sick, Lord. Sister Lumpkin, I ask you, God, to visit her. I ask you, Lord, to stop by her house. I ask you, Lord, to visit her in that home, oh God, and let her know that you love her and you care about her, Lord. I pray for all the people who are joining on, that you'll do a mighty thing for them, oh Lord, today, to the point where they'll sense your touch, sense your presence. And Lord, I thank you. I praise you, Lord, because you are faithful. You're a God of love. You are God, oh Lord, who knows our hurts and knows our pain. And we just thank you, Lord, for all the things you have done. And we magnify you, Lord, today, because you are worthy. And to you, oh God, we give the glory and say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for tuning in today at Power Hour. Thank you. As we are on, keep on typing those prayer requests. Yes, awesome. Keep on typing those prayer requests as we are tuning in. Yes, welcome. Where are you tuning in from? Are you tuning in from Atlanta? Are you out of state, out of the country? Let us know where you are tuning in from. And please share the link to your friends and family members. I'm doing that right now as we are live. Please share the link to friends and family members as we are on Power Hour. At this moment, we have something exciting coming up. Something exciting that I would love for you to be a part of. Don't miss it, because it's going to be powerful by the grace of God. It's going to be powerful. We have a life-transforming experience just for you. In July 11 to July 24th, we have a life-transforming series prepared for you. It's going to be powerful as we talk about let's trust Him. Let's trust Him. So we'd love to invite you, invite your family members and friends to this Let's Trust Him campaign coming up in July, July 11th to July 24th. So I'm going to let you watch this a short video, a promotional video, and we're going to come back, and by the grace of God, we're going to go into the Word in Acts chapter 5 and 6 and magnify Jesus. Let's go. About 3.5 million people died because of COVID. About 247,000 Americans got divorced in 2020. Two-thirds of Gen Zs, they reported that they do not want to come back to church. Trust in the family has been broken. Trust in the leaders of society has been broken. Trust in a spouse has been broken. Which begs the question, is there anyone we can trust? I am glad to report to you that yes, indeed, there is someone we can trust. Join us on July 11th through to July 24th at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time as we journey through a life-transforming experience. You do not want to miss it. Journey with us as we go through 12 reasons why we can trust Him. Jesus is indeed trustworthy because of His love and His faithfulness toward us. They have never failed in spite of all the challenges. And so invite a friend, invite a family, invite a loved one, invite a frenemy, because we're going to have a wonderful time. Let's trust Him. Awesome. Yes, let's trust Him. That is coming up very soon. Let's trust Him in July, July 11th to July 24th. That's going to be such a blessing. So please share this information to your family members and friends and those who you might be ministering to as well. We want them to come out to be blessed by the grace of God. Jesus will be exalted. That's the goal. He will be exalted, and He promises that when He is exalted, He will draw people. He will draw them to Himself. And I believe that God is in the business right now of drawing people to Himself. And so that's exactly what we want to be partakers of, in partnering with Jesus to magnify Him as He draws people to Himself. We're going to turn to Acts. If you have testimonies, type it in the chat. If you have prayer requests, type it in the chat. We will be turning to the book of Acts, an extension of the Gospel of Luke. Going to turn there at the moment, and we're going to feast upon the Word. So it's a discussion. I want you to type in the comment section as well as we discuss this Word today. I want to type in the chat. I'll ask some questions as well from this letter to Theophilus. We'll be asking you to type in the chat, give some feedback as well as we're discussing Acts chapter 5 and 6. I pray that this will liberate somebody today, even myself. I believe that God is going to do something amazing as we go into the scriptures today, as we go into the scriptures today. This week has been a blessing. This has been a blessed week for many of us, in spite of the challenges. So many people have been dying. So many people have lost loved ones, but Jesus has kept us. He has brought us to where we are. And I just want to say thank God for keeping us and for protecting us in spite of the difficulties. So if you have your Bibles, let's turn to Acts chapter 5. We'll be going there. And around 12:30, what we'll be doing is we'll be tuning in to, in a few minutes, we'll be tuning in to bring the Zoom members in. So in a few minutes, we'll be tuning in to bring the Zoom members in, and they will be a part of this conversation. So you'll hear them commenting as well in the background, and so we'll pull them into the feed so they can have a nice discussion with us from Acts chapter 5 and Acts chapter 6, all right? So stick with us by the grace of God. We're going to go into the Word. All right, here we go. Acts chapter 5. You know the story. Acts chapter 5. All right. In Acts chapter 5, we have something in very interesting here as Luke is writing to Theophilus. We find that in chapter 1. And we also find that in Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1 states that he's writing to Theophilus, right? Remember that? He's writing to Theophilus. Theophilus, he has some doubts concerning the gospel and concerning the things that Jesus did, what he taught. He has some doubts. He has some doubts, and that's okay. If you have some doubts, Theophilus asked some questions, and he reached out, and Luke understands what Theophilus is going through. And Luke reaches out through a letter to Theophilus and his readers as well. And so, as Theophilus has these doubts, Luke is arguing to try to strengthen Theophilus' belief in Christ. Yes, in Christ, because he's doubting some of the things that actually took place that Jesus did, because some of the things that Jesus did is actually out of this world. In many Jewish mindset and even in the Gentile mindset, this could not take place because of the teachings that the Jews had set up. So Theophilus is wondering, really? Jesus did all of those things for true? And Luke is saying, yes, indeed, he did all of these things for true. And so just that slight little backdrop I want you to have as we go into the extension of Luke, right? The book of Acts. So Acts chapter 5, right? We have some stories. The first stories we'll read Acts chapter 5, verse 1 to 11, is a story of Ananias and Sapphira. Ananias and Sapphira. You know the story. Ananias should have sold some of the land and given a portion of the money to the church so the gospel could continue to go forward. But he lied against the Holy Spirit and covered up. And his wife did the same thing. Both of them lied to the Holy Spirit and lied to the body of Christ. And Jesus showed the church that when you have something like that, what Jesus is trying to do for us, my friends, is he wants intimacy with all of us. So it's a sad story, and it's a story that you might read and say, how in the world Jesus would do such thing like that to just make them drop dead like that in just a messed up situation that they did? Isn't there any grace? Jesus wanted to teach the early church that he wants intimacy with his children. And Jesus is trying to teach us the same thing, that he wants intimacy with us. He knows us in and out. You can't lie against the Holy Spirit, because he knows you. He knows what you have done, and he knows you inside out. Jesus is showing us that he knows us even when we think he doesn't know us. He knows you intimately and wants intimacy with you. Yes, it's a friendship, it's a relationship, it's a covenant that Christ has entered in with you in relationship. And he wants fairness and truth. Wants fairness and truth in this intimate relationship with us. So that story right there, challenging story, but has a power-packed lesson for the church today. As we go along in the story, we go to verse 12 to verse 16, and the Bible says, hear what the Bible says now. And through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. Yet none of the rest dared join them, but the people esteemed them highly, and believers were increasingly added to the Lord. Here it is. Multitudes of both men and women, so that they brought the sick out into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. Also, a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities to Jerusalem, bringing sick people and those who were tormented by unclean spirits, and they were all healed. This is a powerful thing right here, my friend. Powerful, because Luke shows Theophilus that salvation is not limited to a specific group or a specific gender, but salvation has been made available to everyone who believes. My God, wow. Luke shows Theophilus and the believers here that salvation is not limited to a specific group or a specific gender, but salvation has been made available to everyone who believes. Hallelujah. And so Theophilus, this is shocking to him, because before, if you read the historical background and when you read how the Jewish mindset was, then Gentiles were classified as people who are afar off. But in the text, we realize that the Peter, just by him passing by, people were receiving access to freedom. Satan had bound them with diseases. Satan had bound them with all manner of sickness and demonic possessions. But when God works, my friends, we realize that he doesn't show partiality to who receives healing. The Bible says that as those who pass by, that Jesus used Peter's very own shadow, and people were receiving healing. My God, thank you, Jesus. People were being healed just by the fact that Peter was walking past and the Holy Spirit using him to do wonders. Holy Spirit using him to do wonders. You see what would happen, my friends, in the health covenant. Here it is. In the health covenant, in the previous things, the Jewish mindset was from Exodus 15 verse 26. This shaped their mind as well. Here it is. Exodus 15, 12 to 16. The Bible says, "And through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. Yet none of the rest dared join them. But the people esteemed them highly, and believers were increasing added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women." Here it is. Here it is. In Exodus, here it is. Here it is. So we see that the healing took place in one way, but here it is in Exodus 15, 26. Here it is, Exodus 15, 26, 16, 26, that the Bible says, "And said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord, your God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon you, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that heals you." And so, my friends, what happened was the Jews, they said that once we obey the commandments, once we do what was right in the sight of the Lord, once we eat right, and once we live right, and once we obey the Lord, then no sickness would come up on us. Well, my friends, the covenant here, because now, hear what happened now, because of this text, the Jews said that anyone who receives sickness and anyone who got sick, then it must be associated with some type of sin that they did, or some type of parental sin that took place in the past that now the child is suffering the consequence of that sin. But my friends, I want to let you know that when we read the book of Acts, we see something interesting because Jesus is not doing a spot check or taking a survey on who did any type of sin. In Acts, the Bible is telling me that Jesus is using the apostles to do signs and wonders. Jesus is doing mighty things in the book of Acts as the Spirit of God moves. All those who come to Jesus will receive healing. Jesus is doing a mighty thing. And so now this is baffling. This is baffling the Jews. This is baffling the Gentiles. This is baffling their minds because they have taught that us healing would only be granted to the Jewish people who were keeping the commandments. But Jesus is reaching hurting people. Luke is showing Theophilus that Jesus is reaching hurting people. Hallelujah. And I want to pause there to tell somebody who is on today that Jesus is not showing any partiality in what he does when it comes on to healing. He's showing us today that he is the balm in Gilead. He's showing us today that he is not doing a spot check on whether or not he will heal you. He's not checking to see whether you were faithful in the past or based upon your faithfulness, then I'm going to heal you, or based upon the fact that you're a deacon, or based upon the fact that you're an elder, based upon the fact that you're a faithful member, you pay your tithes, you do all these things, or you go to school, you're in high school and you try to be faithful to the Lord, you don't do any type of sin, you don't smoke and you don't drink and you don't eat certain types of food, but yet still you're wondering why in the world God ain't healing you. I want to let somebody know today that God is not doing a spot check based upon what he does, but he is faithful. He is faithful that at the right time he brings the healing. At the right time he says, "Thou art loose from thy sickness." At the right time God will come through. At the right moment God knows how to come through. You keep praying. You keep calling upon the Lord. Because if it's his will, he will do it. He doesn't show partiality. Whether you're SDA or Baptist or Pentecostal or Methodist or atheist, Jesus can heal you no matter what. And he doesn't show partiality in who he heals. He is faithful. In this story, we see actually Jesus reaching out to all people based upon his Father's will through his Spirit. Whatever the will of the Father is, whatever is best for the congregation, or whatever is best for the people, we see that God demonstrates his love through healing. God demonstrates his power through healing. God demonstrates to the children of Israel and the Gentile nation that he's accepting everyone. We're going to get there shortly. Now, I want to balance out things because Jesus does heal. He's a healer. He can do wonders. He can do mighty things. And also, Jesus continues to teach the children as time goes by. Over time, Jesus teaches them that he does wonders. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 8 to 10, we also see that Paul now, he prays. He is praying. He's a holy man of God. He's walking with the Lord now and doing wonders. He's actually healing people and speaking God's word mighty and powerfully and seeing signs and wonders. And now Paul prays. Here, the lesson. We see in Acts chapter, we see that God is healing. We see that God is doing mighty things. We see that God is moving through the apostles. And also, God is going to balance out things now to show us as believers who are today, who might be struggling to say, why God ain't healing me, or why God ain't coming through, or why God is not doing things for me, or I'm praying and God, you must come through. I believe you're going to come through. Or some people associate not being healed to the lack of faith, but it might be, I want to let you know that God is a miracle worker. And sometimes don't let the devil beat you down to make you think that it's a lack of faith, or you're not spiritual enough, or that God doesn't love you enough. Why he ain't coming through? I want to liberate you through the power of the Spirit of God to let you know that God knows best for your life. Here it is. Here it is. 2 Corinthians 12:8-10. Three times, Paul says, I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is perfected in weakness. Therefore, Paul says, I will boast all the more gladly in my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So that the power of Christ may rest upon me. That is why, for the sake of Christ, I delight in weaknesses, in insults and hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I'm weak, then am I strong. All right, it's time to bring in Power Hour now. I hear them calling my name. And so we're gonna go right now to Power Hour. Gonna bring them in as well, those in. And so we're going to bring them into the live feed at the very present moment. Here it is. Here it is. Here it is. Here it is. So yes, we're in Zoom now. Yes, we're live as well on Facebook and YouTube. We're in Zoom. And so they brought me on 3 minutes earlier. So that's good. That's good. So here it is. We're going to continue now. We're going to continue. Welcome those who are in Zoom. It's glad to see everyone here today. It's a joy to be able to share the gospel of Christ. Can everyone hear properly and clearly from Zoom here? Everyone can hear clearly? Awesome. Awesome. I'm hearing you guys clearly. Sister Velani and everybody, I'm hearing you guys very clearly now. Beautiful. Beautiful. So talking about the gospel. Talking about the gospel here. The gospel is powerful because it shows the balance. In Acts chapter 5, we see that just by the very shadow of Peter passing by, that people were being healed. The God was doing so much things in Acts chapter 5 that they would bring people, sick people, and lay them down on the streets. And as Peter walked past, just by his shadow, people were getting up. The lame was walking again, and the dumb was talking again, and the dead was being raised again, and the demon possessed was being liberated again. God was doing wonders. Wonders through the apostles. And now we see that God is not showing partiality in who he heals or what he does. God is just doing wonders. Doing wonders. So Luke is showing Theophilus that Jesus is actually working miracles. Jesus is actually doing powerful things. Jesus is actually doing things that the Gentiles are not approved of. Jesus is doing something amazing by opening the door of healing Jews and Gentiles. Wow, 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 wow. And so now we have the balance in Exodus 16:26, where though we see Jesus healing so much people, we also see that the balance is that when we ask the question, God, why aren't you healing me? I've been praying, fasting, calling on the Lord, and praying all throughout the night, and eating right. I've been doing these things, Lord, so why are you ain't healing me? Well, a man by the name of Paul in the book of Corinthians shows us as well that God knows best for our lives.
God knows best. He says that three times, Lord, I cried out to you. I pleaded for you to heal me, and I called on you, but somehow the Bible says that God, Paul received the voice by voice of God to say that my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is being perfected in weaknesses. And so, my friend, sometimes you might pray. Sometimes you might cry to the Lord, and you will be healed sometimes. Glory to God. But there are some times where the Lord might say, you know what? It's best for you to carry on in this weakness. It's best for you to carry on in this sickness. It's best for you to carry on for now. But I have a plan, an ultimate plan. When I return, I'm going to ultimately heal you. So there's a balance. There is this two-way street that God takes sometimes. But whatever is best for your life, he chooses and he gives you peace. He gives you peace and gives you strength for the journey. He gives you strength for the struggle. The gospel story is very balanced. Gospel story, very balanced. So now as we continue to journey along in Acts chapter 5, I'm heading somewhere. Stay with it. Stay with it. Stay on the ship. Stay on the ship. We're sailing somewhere. Stay on the ship. As we go along, we see something interesting in verse 15 to 16 of Acts 5. The Bible says, they carried out the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats, that as Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on some of them, right? And so now, we see that's a miracle that is being taken place. That's a miracle. That's miracles being taken place in the book of Acts chapter 5. Now, when we go to verse 17 to 21, we see something interesting as well. The Bible says, now when all these healings are taking place and God is doing wonders through the apostles in them preaching the gospel, they're preaching the gospel, and they lock these men up. They lock them up for the preaching of the gospel story, because they don't want these men to be preaching the gospel. The gospel is liberating everybody. The gospel is freeing the Gentiles. The gospel is freeing the Jews. The gospel is tearing down walls and barriers and going to places that have never gone before. And people who were bound became free. The gospel is going to places. And the priests, high priests, they don't like that. So they arose. They rose up. Verse 17, 21. And all who were with him, that is a part of the Sadducees, and filled with jealousy. Verse 18, they arrested the apostles and put them in the public prison. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened, are you hearing this? Opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, go and stand in the temple and speak. Hallelujah. Speak to the people all the words of this life. When they heard this, they entered the temple at daybreak and began to teach. Wow. My question to you now, Maranatha, and those who are online, Sister Deborah and all of those online. My question is, what do you notice here from this passage? What do you think Luke is trying to tell Theophilus and his readers? What do you think? What do you think Luke is trying to say here? I'll read it one more time. Here it is. So, Acts chapter 5, you hear what the Bible says, 17 to 21. The high priest rose up and all who were with him. They arrested the apostles and put them in the public prison. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, go and stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life. Wow. Wow. You see, this is powerful. Why? It's because it shows something interesting. And I'm going to read one more text to help strengthen this, what I'm going to say. Here it is. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. But you shall receive power. Hallelujah. When the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem. And all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Here it is. The gospel, my friends, since there is a prophetic charge on the disciples' life to spread the word in Jerusalem and out of the borders of Jerusalem, then early confinement to the prison walls would interfere with the prophetic word of the Lord. Did you hear that? Early confinement to the prison walls would interfere with the prophetic word of the Lord. God had a prophetic word upon the disciples that I am going to give you power through the Holy Spirit to go and preach the gospel to the Samaritans, to the Judeans, those in Jerusalem, and all the ends of the earth. But here comes this high priest who rose up and put them behind the prison bars. But God is saying to the high priest and to the institutions that institutions cannot stop the word of God from going forth to liberate people. Because when God speaks a word, no institutions, no governments, no society can stop the gospel from going out. So God sent an angel to come down to loose these men and say, go speak the word. Speak the gospel story that Jesus died and rose again in victory. So no institutions could stop the gospel from reaching the people who were bound. Mm-hmm. God said, go speak the gospel. And they tried to stop the gospel through institutions. God said, no, sir, that's not going to work. So Luke shows that institutions couldn't and cannot stop the word of God from being preached. You got to understand what Luke is doing, church. Luke is showing Theophilus that, listen, miracles are taking place. Listen, divine intervention is taking place. People are being healed, and also angels are descending and ascending and going up and down to ensure that the gospel is being carried forth. Because Jesus, they tried to put institutions around the tomb, but my friends, institutions and societies and laws could not even stop the Jesus from getting up out of the tomb, because there was a prophetic word upon the life of Jesus that 3 days and you will rise again. And I want to let somebody know that when there is a prophetic word over your life, when God has a word over your life, no institution, no government, no society, nothing can stop you from going forward. Lord, hallelujah. That word was for somebody. I said, no institution, no witchcraft, no backbiting, no word from the enemy, no thing that the devil might try can stop you from going forward. Because there's an empty tomb, because there's an empty jail as well, because God says that you shall preach the word. When God tells, God prophesies a word over your life, not even in his sickness, when God says, child of God, I declare you healed, no sickness can stop you from going forward. Oh God, God knows, my friends, that when he has a mission, when he has a purpose for your life, and God has spoken to you, nothing at all can stop you from going forward. Nothing at all. In Acts chapter 5, verse 27 to 39, hear what takes place again. When they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest questioned them, saying, we strictly charge you not to teach in this name. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us. But Peter and the apostles answered, we must obey God rather than man. I'm sorry. Must obey God rather than man. The God of our fathers raised Jesus. Hear the gospel now. Raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things. And so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. When they heard this, they were enraged and wanted to kill them. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, held in honor by all the people, stood up and gave orders to put the men outside for a little while. And he said to the men of Israel, take care what you are about to do with these men. For before these days, Theudas rose up claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. Here it is. Here it is. Verse 38. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of man, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found opposing God. So they took his advice. What do you guys think about this? Discussion. Those in Zoom, what do you think?
See that just by the very shadow of Peter, that people were being healed. The God
yes,
was doing
I'm not hearing clearly. Go again.
They would bring people, sick people, lay them down on the streets. And as Peter walked past,
somebody even on YouTube, I think they're playing on YouTube the live feed. If you could mute that as well, please. Thank you. All right. Yes. So as we go right along, as we go along, what we hear, what's going on is we see that. Yeah, somebody's still playing it on their device. Could you mute that on YouTube or Facebook? I'm getting that feedback. All right. Thank you. All right. So what we have here is institutions. Here it is. Institutions or governments couldn't stop the preached word from going forward. Just as how the grave couldn't stop the living word from getting up on Sunday morning. I'll repeat. Institutions or government. Here's the conclusion. They couldn't stop the preached word from going forward. Just as how the grave couldn't stop the living word from getting up on Sunday morning. You see, when Jesus, my friends, has a calling on your life, as I said, nothing, no satanic attacks can prevail over your life, because God has a declared word for you to go forward. No wonder Paul says we are pressed down on every side but not crushed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I want to tell somebody today that when God has his hands laid upon you and a prophetic word, no, nothing at all can stop the word of God over your life from coming through. If God had said you're gonna get married, don't let circumstances or situations make you think that God's word will not come to pass. If God says you will have a daughter, you will have a son, you will have a child, don't let the fact that the doctors say that you are barren stop you from believing that God is going to come through. If God says that you are healed, don't let the sickness make you think that you won't be healed. I want to let somebody know today that God's word will not return void. Someone needs to be encouraged with this word today, that you are perplexed, you are down, you are feeling like you're cast away, but God never fails. He never fails, child of God. He always comes through. A promise delayed is not a promise denied. Not because it's delayed, not because it's taking long, not because it's 2021 and you heard the word of God in 2019, not because you heard the word last year, not because it seems like the guy you're dating, not because he's not proposing to you now, not because he's not showing interest, not because he postponed the marriage, not because there's a delay. That does not mean that this is not God's will. Hold on to the word of the Lord, because God knows how to come through right on time. That's a word for somebody. That's a word. And so there was a prophetic word that went away, that went ahead as well. When it comes on to the gospel story, there's a prophetic word Here's the prophetic word. Here is it. The prophetic word came from a Daniel. Daniel chapter 9, 24 to 27. Anyone has a Bible near them, you could read Daniel chapter 9, 24 to 27 for us, please. Ella Woodley, you have a Bible nearby, want to read Daniel chapter 9, 24 to 27. Listen this word here. A prophetic word went out, and listen how God ensured that it came to pass. This prophetic word, I'll continue reading for time's sake. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Verse 25, hear the word, Lord. This word is a powerful word. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublesome time. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off. But not for himself, and the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood, and till the end of the war, desolations are determined. Verse 27, then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice, an offering. Here it is. So sacrifices, offering, they will come to an end in the middle of the week. And on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation, which is determined, is poured out on the desolate. Wow. This is heavy, fully loaded. We're going to flush this out in the upcoming evangelistic meeting in July 11 to 24. We're going to flush that out some more. I'm going to give you an overview just for now, just to whet your appetite, just to whet your appetite for now. Here it is. So we have this prophetic message that went out. 70 weeks are determined upon the people. Here it is. So 69 weeks. When we take, my friends, we hear the gospel story from Daniel. From Daniel chapter 9, we hear the gospel story that that from the going forth of the commandment, which is found in Ezra 4 and 6, you'll find it out, from the going forth of the commandment to rebuild Jerusalem. Now the question is, when was that? When you do some historical background, you'll find out that in 457 BC, this was taking place in Ezra chapter 4. Now, from the going forth of the commandment unto the Messiah, we see that it would be the 69 weeks should be cut off. That 69 weeks would be completed when you do your historical check. That's 483 years. So we go there, the 69 weeks is cut off. And when this prophetic message went forth, my friends, we see that the 69 weeks, it was fulfilled to the T when Jesus was baptized. And the Bible says in Luke recorded that the Holy Spirit came down upon Jesus, and Jesus was anointed with a dove pitching upon him, and God said, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Well, at that very same moment in AD 27, that was a prophetic message being fulfilled. The prophetic message was fulfilled. 69 weeks, Messiah would come, the anointed one. That's a Hebrew interpretation of the Messiah. The Messiah, the prince, he would be anointed. And taking from the going forth of the commandment, when the going forth of the commandment to rebuild Jerusalem, taking from that starting point to when Messiah came, the anointed one, the 69 weeks is fulfilled on the very exact day it was prophesied, showing us that the word of God never fails, showing us that when God says one thing, he does not say two things. When God says it will come to pass, I mean that it will come to pass. So child of God, don't you fear, don't be anxious, don't you worry. Remember Lazarus, he was 4 days dead. Jesus says, I'm coming by. But even though 4 days dead, Jesus still came and fulfilled his word. And so remember that Jesus never fails. He always comes through. He always comes through when he does a prophetic message. So we see the 6 and 9 weeks cut off. So now we have one more week left to fulfill the 70-week prophecy. One more week. Now the Bible tells us that in the midst of the week, in verse 27, then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. So Jesus now, so now we have 69 weeks. So we have 1 week left, or 7 days, right? Now in prophetic messages, we understand that days are equivalent to years. So one day is equivalent to 1 year, or 7 days, 7 years. So now in the midst of those 7 years, are you following me? In the midst of those 7 years, Messiah would make an end to the sacrifices. You remember the sacrifices? The killing of the lamb and the killing of the animals to make a sacrifice for sin, because they would go to the priest and the priest would offer a sacrifice for the cleansing of our, an atonement would take place for the people who sin. But the Bible says that when Christ would die, that an end to those sacrifices and offerings would cease. Well, just as how the prophetic message went out, we know that Jesus spent 3.5 years in his public ministry from the time he was anointed to the time he died on Calvary. That's 3.5 years. And Jesus, within those 3.5 years, told the disciples in Luke 4, go to the Jewish nation, not to the Samaritans, not to the ends of the earth. Yet, I have a gospel story for the Jews. So the gospel within those 3.5 years primarily focused on the Jews, because God's ideal was to reach the Jews who he chose, who he accepted, for them now to carry the gospel to the ends of the earth. That was God's ideal. But you're going to see something why the other 3.5 years had to come into play. Now, in the midst of the week, in the midst of the 7 years, in the midst of that week, Messiah would cut off. Now, the Bible tells us that Jesus died. He died. He died. Now, when Jesus died, what took place? Anybody remember what took place when Jesus died? You can give me some feedback.
In two.
Hello. Somebody said it. Somebody said it. So hear what happened, my friends. Hear what happened when Jesus died on Calvary. Here's a gospel story. It is beautiful. When Jesus died on Calvary, the spotless Lamb of God died, my friends. And Hebrew picks it up to tell us that now, my friends, we are not supposed to go to priests to be able to receive forgiveness of sins, because one person died once and for all. Jesus Christ, the spotless Lamb of God, was slain on Calvary. And while the priest was about to kill the lamb on the Passover day, the greatest Passover lamb was hanging on Calvary, breathing his last breath for your sins and my sins, so that we don't have to buy doves and lambs to be able to make sacrifices anymore, because Jesus died for your sin and my sin. So that lamb in the temple ran away, and the Bible tells us that there was the veil of the temple was torn from top to bottom, symbolizing that the mighty hand of the Father reached down and split the temple, showing us that Jesus died for all humanity. Jesus sacrificed his life for all of us, and now there's forgiveness of sins available in Jesus Christ, not in the blood of a lamb, not in the blood of a man, not in the blood of bulls and goats and dung, but Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so now, my friends, you don't have to go to the priest to receive forgiveness.
No, sir.
You don't have to go on Sunday morning to confess your sins to the priest and say, "Oh, priest, I forgave, I sinned, I committed fornication last night, I lied, I cheated last night, I did not pay enough tithes and offering." But my friends, you can go to the foot of the cross, because the Bible lets us know that anyone who comes to Him and confess their sins, Jesus is faithful and just to forgive them from not just one sin or two sins, but from all their sins and all unrighteousness. Jesus says, "Come unto me. Come, yes, though your sins are like scarlet, I'll make them white, like light whiter than snow. Come, come, Jesus." Man. There is forgiveness available in Jesus. So that took place in the midst of the week. Sacrifices ceased. No need to be keeping Passover. No need to be killing animals. No need to be sacrificing animals for a symbol of sacrifice for sin, because Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God, died for you.
Amen.
And me. And now three and a half years left.
Amen.
And now Jesus said, "You know what I want you to do? I want you to continue to bring the gospel to the Jews. Give them another chance." Jesus is the God of second chances. You know that? He says 70 weeks are determined. It's going to be cut off. It's going to be a public invitation for the Jews to accept me as their Messiah. Accept me as the one who loves them. But my friends, Jesus gave them another chance and another chance and another chance. And that's what Jesus does for you. He gives you another chance and another chance and another chance. He keeps on giving chances for you to come to Him. And right now, He's calling you to come to Him. And He's giving you another chance and another chance. He's saying, "Child of God,
yeah,
I've seen you out there long enough. You're going to the club. You're going to all of these activities and straying away from me. And I'm giving you another chance. I see you cheating every now and then. And I'm giving you another chance and another chance. I've seen you backsliding. And I'm giving you another chance. I see you hooked with pornography. And I'm giving you another chance and another chance." Jesus is the God of second chances and third chances and a thousand chances. God knows how to give chances. Hallelujah. Thank God for the chances He gave me. Thank God for the times when I messed up and He said, "I'm giving you another chance." Hallelujah. Another chance. So 3.5 years, gave them another chance. But in Acts, in the book of Acts, we see that something took place when the stoning of Stephen took place. Because the disciples, my friends, in the end of 6:7, you see the stoning of Stephen taking place. And at that very moment when the Jews, that Stephen said, "I see heaven open and Jesus sitting at the right hand of God." You remember the gospel story that Acts, that the apostles were preaching to the high priest? They said, "Hey, you killed Jesus, but God raised him up to be by the right hand of God." That was the gospel message they were preaching. And so Stephen now, at the stoning of Stephen, Stephen said that very same thing. Stephen says, "I see heaven open and I see the Son of Man seated by the right hand of God." Hallelujah. Whoop. God exalted Jesus to be seated at His right hand. And they stoned Stephen publicly by saying, "This Jesus that you're talking about, we don't want Him. He is a heretic. He is not the God. He is not God. He's not no Messiah." They rejected Jesus publicly. And at the end of that was AD 34. That completes a 70-week prophecy from 457 BC to 34 AD. That ends the 70-week prophecy fulfilled to its T. At that moment, it was announced publicly to take the gospel to everybody. Take it to the Samaritans, to the Jews, to the ends of the earth. Take it everywhere. Take it everywhere. And so the gospel now was extended to all people now, all people, for them to receive salvation through Jesus. salvation through Jesus. Jesus gave them some time. Jesus gave them some time because God had an ideal plan to use them to reach others. But now Jesus shows that when he died, when he rose from the dead, the gospel story is that Jesus now accepts everybody. Jesus calls everybody his peculiar people. Jesus calls everyone who receives him his chosen generation, royal priesthood. All of us now, my friends, are welcome to be a part of the family of God. Hallelujah. Now, Paul picked it up in Ephesians 2 to say, hey, you guys were Gentiles afar off from the commonwealth of Israel. You guys were not a part of this covenant, but somehow Jesus, when he died, he welcomed you into his grace and to be part of the family of God. John picked it up in his gospel story by saying, what manner of love is this that the Father would call us his own children, sons and daughters of God. This is a gospel story. I hope you're hearing the story this afternoon, because Jesus is saying to somebody today that I've welcomed you in. I've accepted you to be a part of the family of God. No matter where you have been before, no matter your history, no matter your past, no matter your story, I've welcomed you in. I've accepted you into the family of God. You might be messed up right now, but I still accept you as my own daughter and as my own son. I love you with an everlasting love. So this is unconditional acceptance now. Unconditional acceptance that Luke shows us. So Luke shows us gospel extension that Jesus is accepting everybody. He's accepting Jews. He's accepting Gentiles. He's accepting Samaritans. He's accepting Judeans. He is accepting everybody. Hallelujah. Now, Luke is the only person to show it, to strengthen the argument that Luke is showing this. Luke includes a story in his gospel to show the unconditional love of the Father. No other gospel writer includes this in their gospel. Luke is on a mission to strengthen Theophilus' belief in the all-loving Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Luke shows us, my friends, that Jesus has accepted you. Wow. Jesus has accepted you just as you are. You don't have to dress nicely. Though that's nice, but you don't have to do it for him to accept you. You don't have to live right for him to accept you. You don't have to do one single thing for him to accept you. Why? Because he has accepted, Lord of mercy. He has accepted you before. When he died on Calvary, before the foundation of the earth, Christ says, I accept you. You are accepted. Through the blood of Jesus, you are accepted to be part of the family of God. And now allow Jesus to live through you. Allow Jesus to do right through you. Allow Jesus, my friends, to live out the righteousness through you, because Jesus has accepted you. So don't try to live in a way to be accepted by God. Don't try to live in a way to try to please God. Don't try to live in a way to wanting to feel accepted by God, because none of your works can make God accept you more than he accepts you already. Jesus accepts you unconditionally. The Bible says, while you were yet sinners, Christ died for you. Yeah. It was in our mess, in our sins, in our weaknesses, Christ accepted us anyway. Wow. Christ accepts us, my friends, just like that. Just like that, Christ accepts us. And so, as we close, there's so much more to say, but I've run out of time. Not run out of words, but run out of time. Not run out of the gospel, but run out of time. So remember now, Jesus healing everybody, showing his unconditional acceptance, like what Luke is doing. Jesus also shows us that his prophetic word, when he prophesies the word of God, the gospel story, no institution, no government, no system can stop the word of God from going forward. Nothing at all can stop the word of God. And so it is that when God speaks a word over our lives, that nothing can stop that word from coming to pass.
Never.
No circumstances, never. No situations, no never. Obstacle, no mountain, no long valley can stop the word of God from fulfilling in your life. When God says something, he makes sure that it comes to pass. We see that. We see also that Luke is showing Theophilus that Jesus is welcoming Jews and Gentiles and everybody now. Everybody who wants to receive Jesus has the opportunity to receive him, because all of us now are sons and daughters of God as we work, as we invite, as we accept this invitation. Because the invitation is for you. Invitation is for you. That because Jesus has accepted you, will you accept his love for you? Will you accept him in your life? Will you receive him into your heart today? Because he loves you more than anything. That's the gospel. That's the gospel. Father, thank you for the gospel. Thank you so much that your gospel frees us. Thank you so much that we can come to you, Lord, and enjoy this blessed hope in you. Thank you so much that you have accepted me, Lord, and accepted us while we were messed up, while we were sinful. You said, that's my son, that's my daughter, that's my child. I love them, I love them, I can't do without them. So Jesus, you came down from so high to so low to accept us and embrace us in your love. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. No, Lord, help us to accept you. Reign in our hearts. Live through us. Help us to be confident that, Lord, you have forgiven us and you have accepted us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.
Amen.
God bless amen. You. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank and praise the Lord for the word. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Ness.
Amen.
And you have an announcement?
Yes, announcements. Just to let you know that there's something interesting coming up. Something very interesting coming up. That is July 11th to July 24th. We have something very interesting. Anybody knows what that is?
Revival?
Yep, you're on point. You're on point. Yes, we have an evangelistic meeting coming up on that same day, July 11th to the 24th. And what we would love for you to do is to share. So please take a moment to share.